Hi, this is Father Bill W. here in Austin, Texas. Welcome to the podcast. I'm an Episcopal priest. I'm in long-term recovery from alcoholism, and my sobriety date is December the 27th, 1972. Many thanks to all the people who have helped me along the way and the many friends that I've made in the program who we've helped together since then. So if you're a regular listener, welcome back. If you're new, I hope you'll sign up for our newsletter. You can do so on our two-way prayer website, or you can write to me at two-way prayer, T-W-O, two-way prayer, at gmail.com. This is our fifth episode in the series we're doing, and we're exploring here the morning prayer and meditation practices of Oxford Group members and the early members, the pioneers in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. And they called it a morning quiet time with God. I'm using as a study guide Dick B's book, Good Morning. It's called Good Morning, Quiet Time, Morning Watch, Meditation, and Early AA. I'll put a link to that in the show notes. Many of us, you know, have a long way to go in improving our prayer and meditation techniques and practices. This was something that was really difficult for me when I came into the program, and for the first 20 years until I kind of discovered the methods that they were using in this early AA time that never quite made it over into the regular program. And what winds up happening is many of us in recovery learn to rely on meditation books like the 24-hour-a-day book or One Day at a Time in This or That Fellowship. But the problem is that, you know, when we do this, we're actually reading somebody else's meditation instead of experiencing one of our own. And that really kind of gets to the heart and soul of what the quiet time is all about. And Dick starts off this chapter with a quote that I like. It's from an AA historian, deceased, Ernie Kurtz. He's the author of Not God, A History of Alcoholics Anonymous. My guess is some of you are familiar with some of Ernie's work. And Ernie writes this. He says, there are not only many meditation books today, there are too many. Squibs for daily meditation are useful for beginners, but perhaps some are being locked in to beginnerhood, into spiritual infancy. Meditation, like food, loses nutrients when it is canned. So a little sarcasm there from Ernie, but I think what he's saying is absolutely true. And, you know, when I do a workshop, a Zoom workshop, and I listen at, you know, at the close of it to 10 or 20 people reading their two-way prayers, often it's the first time, the very first time they've ever heard something directly from God. And what often happens is they choke up, they start to cry. Why? Because it's so intimate. And it's also so very specific to their need. And I wonder why they would ever kind of go back to settle into canned food and meditation again after that. I know once I discovered it, it began a process with me that has continued for 28 years, and I found an excitement there that was really missing in the program without it. So I just think it's one of the most unique features of early AA and Oxford Group, and something that I feel very committed to trying to get the word out to people in 12-step fellowships to try this thing and learn about it and put it to work in their lives. Dick breaks his chapter down into a number of subheadings, and this is a particularly long chapter, and I'm not going to have time to discuss each one of the subheadings, but I'll go through a good number of them. His first is this. He calls it a definite, adequate, early time. In other words, when is it best to do this quiet time practice, and for how long? In the Oxford Group, people almost to a person recommended that the practice be done first thing in the morning. Here's a quote from Donald Carruthers, an Oxford Group writer. He says, "Have a definite time each morning. The morning period before breakfast is most desirable. Day telegrams are deliverable immediately. Night telegrams are delayed until the following morning. Give God the first moments of your day. It will remove the friction from the rest of the day's duties." I mean, there are times I've missed my quiet time in the morning, and it really does make for a different kind of day. I'm sort of out there on my own. I'm not, I didn't make that initial strong connection. And I don't feel like I'm operating under guidance, under orders for the rest of the day. Try to keep those to a real minimum. But mornings are not the only time. We got to be clear about that. While they are the best, they're not the only time. He's got a quote in there from Shoemaker, how one of his most profound ones came not in the morning, but later in the day. They also did a thing called fingertip guidance, where they would, if they couldn't write and a thought was in their minds, a thought that they thought was coming from God, they would join their thumb and their index finger together and kind of make that connection to God. Kind of like an electrical circuit is now closed and operating. And then they would listen for the voice and receive the guidance that is really, it's a voice that is inside, I believe, each and every one of us. How long do you do it? Most of the authors recommend at least a half an hour. Some an hour or even more. But I would say this, and I come across this often in the literature, that 10, 15 minutes every day is better than a long session of 2 hours once a week. So there's a rhythm to this practice. It's getting up early. It's meeting God before maybe the rest of the people in the house are getting up and sealing that connection with him. Well, the next subheading is a quiet, peaceful, relaxed stance. In other words, how and where do I do my quiet time? Dick quotes from Carruthers again. He says this, "Have a definite place where you can be alone. Learn to concentrate on heavenly thoughts. Even surrounded by others, amid real confusion, it is an art to become unmindful of others when absorbed in communion. Seek the out-of-doors frequently to feel the holy rush of nature newly born. Make your bedroom a gateway into his presence. Shut the door on the world and all that would distract. Closet yourself with the Lord. Let nothing on your part make such intimacy difficult." So I mean, I hope you can feel that it's a special time. It's reserved to make that conscious contact with God. And then, as I did in, I think, the last series, also to allow the unconscious contact with God to begin surfacing in my life as I sit there with my pen in hand and notebook and begin to write down the thoughts that come, the way I practice it, in answer to a specific question, a need that I have, wherein I am genuinely in need of God's guidance. I really believe most of us alcoholics and addicts are disconnected people, and you really boil it down to what's addiction about. It's trying to fill that disconnect. To connect with something, could be food, could be sex, could be gambling, but it's something to connect me because I'm feeling alone and isolated. And that is one of the reasons I really believe that this process is so critical to recovery and to getting better results with our recovery rates. Oxford Group writer Howard Rose suggests, get into a comfortable position. Sit, recline, or kneel, whichever gives greater relaxation of mind and body. Cultivate stillness of the mind by an act of the will thinking peaceful and restful thoughts. Have unhurried quiet and sense of leisure, avoiding all tenseness. This is a real time for letting go of sinking into God's arms. And I think those who've done it for a while know exactly what I'm talking about. We say let go, and let go to whom? Let go to what? I mean, that's what we're finding in this quiet time with God. The next section is on reading, and we talked about this in a previous episode, so I'm not going to go deeply into it, but one thing that is really important to point out is the Oxford Group belief that God reveals his will for us in, in at least two ways. They believed God had what they called his general will, which is his will for everybody. And their belief was that this could be found in the scriptures. And for many of us, I believe, this is certainly true in my case, we find God's will, at least at first, in the big book. You know, I mean, the two things I knew about God's will in my early days of recovery was do not drink. It was never, never could I convince myself it's God's will I go pick up a drink. And the other thing that for me, because I was a runner, and I was just really clear about this, God's will for me was that I not run, that I stay and go through this thing, because I had tried before and I had run before, and I knew that that was his will. And so those are the beginning kinds of things. But when I'd read the big book, it was like this thing was really being directed to me. We know that the words are spoken to us, and we need to pay attention to them if we want to live. In his next section, Dick talks about prayer and some of the different kinds of prayer. And in this little subsection, he quotes frequently from Ann Smith, Dr. Bob's wife, and in one of the first ones, he quotes where she's relating information from Harry Emerson Fosdick. That was one of her favorite authors. And Fosdick wrote, "Prayer," this was in her journal, "is neither chiefly begging for things, nor is it merely self-communing. It is the loftiest experience within the reach of any soul, communion with God." See, everybody, prayer and meditation, we make it sound so difficult, so challenging. Oh, it's just for people who've, can get into the lotus position. They're the ones who can do this. Nonsense. It's for everybody. And it's that connecting with our source and listening to that source speak to us and guide us through life. And I mean, we've been listening to the ego, and we listen to other voices inside of our minds. Well, there's another one. And some of us call that God. In her journal, Ann Smith speaks of the different kinds of prayer that she tried to practice. Intercessory prayer was one, praying that the Spirit may tell you what to pray for. This is a quote from her. "What would you have me ask today?" And sometimes when we show up in two-way prayer, that is the first question is, what is my question? What would you have me ask? Lead me. I don't always maybe show up with a very definite problem. So where do you want to go this morning? Petitionary prayers. And she quotes, this is a quote, "expressions of our wants, which we deeply feel, in which it would be hypocrisy to pretend we didn't. These we submit because he is our friend. Similarly, it would be unnatural not to submit to God the needs of others." So I'm not quite sure where the big book reference to never praying for ourselves came from. But it was certainly something that the people in the Oxford group did and early AAs did. And I don't see anything wrong with it. You know, I think it says, you know, only if others can be helped. And I understand that you want to avoid, giving God orders or things like that. But we have needs, and God knows we have needs. And to bring these needs to God is not a bad thing. I don't know too many spiritual directors and folks who would argue otherwise. So if you got some insights into where that where Bill came up with that piece, or how it, maybe it's best interpreted, love to hear from you on that. Dick has a major section on then specifically hearing from God, and there it's a very important that he has this quote from Shoemaker, and he says this: "We believe entirely that conversion is the experience which initiates the new life, but we're not fools enough to think that the beginning is the end. All subsequent life is a development of the relationship with God which conversion opened. For us, its daily focal point is what we call the quiet time. The distinguishing element of a quiet time is listening for the guidance of God. Speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth, is the expectant mood of a quiet time. The validity of what we believe to be God's guidance must show itself in the long run by more acute moral perception." It's almost like some promises. More acute moral perception. We sharpen our morals in this process. More genuine human relationships. We who had been cut off now begin to bond with people in ways that we never would have thought possible. And an increasing assurance of what one ought to do with each hour of the day. So, and there's the guidance. There's the guidance. What would you have me do this day? Shoemaker writes, "There is a plan he has for us, bigger than our own plan, and we are afraid of it. Somewhere we hold back. Somewhere we keep control of our own destiny. Let go. Abandon yourself to him. Say to him, not my will, but thine be done. Live it. Pray for it. Put yourself at his disposal for time and eternity." So there's Shoemaker, and it could come right out of the big book, eh? And you know, Jung speaks about this voice inside of us. He calls it the self with a capital S, and he refers to a greater self within us that has work for us to do, has business with us, that he goes so far as to say wants to incarnate in us and wants us to do what? To become all that we can be. And that, to me, that is the voice. It's listening for that inner self, the self that is already in contact with God. It's not the ego voice. And you start doing this process, you'll get really clear over time. This is the ego. This is not. This is something different. Luminous thoughts is what they used to call them. Luminous thoughts. Thoughts that have a light around them. And the voice that has a sound to it that you will, I promise you, get to know. Dick lists another quote here, and this one is from Cecil Rose from a book titled When Man Listens. And Rose writes, "God has a plan. God speaks. But if he is to be heard and his plan is to be known and carried out, man must listen. This means a new approach to God for many of us. Our attitude when we have prayed has been, listen, Lord, for thy servant speaketh. Prayer, when it consists of this one-sided address by us to God, becomes increasingly unreal, and it eventually dropped or only formally is retained. Prayer begins with the desire to know God's will for us. The promise that our petitions will be answered is only to those who have first placed themselves in line with his will. If God is to become for us the living, active God at work, directing our life and the world's, it is vital that we should learn how to listen. There is one condition, Rose says, to be fulfilled before we begin. We must be willing to hear anything God says to us. The important thing is for us to make, each for himself, the thrilling discovery that God has spoken to us. Once we have made that discovery, God will shape our quiet times and develop them until they express a full personal relationship with him. We are learning to know his voice in our quiet time. So there's the process. There's the journey. Writing thoughts down is the next section that Dick tackles as part of their process. And here again, he quotes from Shoemaker. And Shoemaker, as you recall, was kind of the spiritual mentor to Bill Wilson. Bill wanted Sam to write the steps, and Sam said, no, an alcoholic has to do it. So he was very, very close to Bill for much of his life. Shoemaker says this: most of us find it indispensable to have a loose-leaf notebook in which to write down the things which come to us. We find it impossible to remember sometimes the things which come even in a brief, quiet time. The Chinese have a saying that the strongest memory is weaker than the weakest ink. We do not want to forget the slightest thing that God tells us to do, and I have sometimes had a rush of detailed guidance which came almost as fast as I could write it. And Bill Wilson, you know, reports something quite similar when he wrote the steps and was asking God for guidance. You know, show me what it is you want me to communicate in a certain number of steps that would take the Oxford Group program and make it applicable to alcoholics. And that was how it came about. A few more little sections before we finish up here. And the first is checking the guidance. It's really important. And a nice quote that Dick has here from Cecil Rose once again. And Rose writes this. He says, of course, every thought that comes to us in the quiet time is not God's guidance. We need to test the voices that come to us along a line that has been so long disused and blocked. So the line of communication between God and us hasn't been real active, you know. So be very careful that, you know, sit down during a quiet time while God tells me to move to Chicago. Do not start packing your bags. That's what I tell people. We have immediate cause to reject promptings which conflict with what we already know of his will. Nothing which is unloving, impure, dishonest, or selfish comes from God. Other suggestions which come to us may have to be talked out with some experienced person who knows how to listen to God. In other cases, we may have to wait for clearer conviction in our minds. Sometimes the only test is to make the venture and act. We shall make mistakes, but an honest mistake is of far more use to God than the timid inaction which makes no venture. Sounds like it's right out of the Big Book, where Wilson, you know, is saying in the beginning, when we are new at this process, we may do some foolish things. I mean, that's exactly the kind of attitude that he's referring to in that line from the Big Book. And then finally, he looks at blockages, things that get in the way, things that stop the voice from speaking to us. And this, again, is a place where he quotes Shoemaker. And Shoemaker writes this: what if I don't seem to get any definite thoughts? God's guidance is as freely available as the air we breathe. If I am not receiving thoughts when I listen, the fault is not God's. Usually, it is because of something I will not do. Then he lists some of these things. See if any of them fit. I can relate to a few. A, something wrong in my life that I will not face and make right. So if that's going on, watch for the guidance to start drying up. A habit or an indulgence I will not give up. A person I will not forgive. A wrong relationship in my life I will not give up. A restitution I will not make. Something God has already told me to do that I will not obey. Check these points and be honest. Then try listening again. I get that question a lot. I don't have anything to ask. I don't have any need in the morning. What should I do? I just sit there and feel like I'm just doing God's will, I guess. I gotta say, I really can't relate to that. Maybe my ego is a lot sicker than many out there, but boy, I always am able to find some things like this that I'm clinging to, I'm hanging on to. The book says the results were nil until we let go absolutely. I remember I was in Louisiana and had a sponsor over there. And in a moment of exuberation, I was given an AA talk, and I said in the talk, half measures availed us nothing. And my old sponsor in the back of the room cried out, oh, BS, I got 35 years on half measures. And I knew he was right. Half measures avail us quite a bit, and if we're honest, many times in our lives during the day, we're operating on half measures. And you know what? That's okay. Not to stay there, but to recognize that that's where I am, and to recognize that the irritability, the discontent, and all of the stuff that comes up in me is there exactly because there are things that I will not give up, that I will not forgive, that I will not let go of. And, it's not a bad thing. I got to stop thinking of it that way. There's the area that I got to go to work on. There's the area that I got to come back to in my next day of meeting up with God. And what I get from God is, are you a little more ready now? How was that one? And not in a mean, vicious way, but in a, are you ready now to let go? Are you ready now to let me into your life? Are you ready now to do this thing differently? And, that kind of thing keeps the program alive, and it keeps the spiritual journey alive. And I'm into, I guess, my 49th year now of doing this thing. And I tell you, since I hit on this two-way prayer process, I have not been bored, and I ain't done yet. So anyway, we had lots of quotes in this episode. I hope some of these have given you some good insights into how the early AAs prayed, and hope you sense some of the excitement that's available in this process. So thank you once again for listening. Again, hope it was helpful. God bless, and keep coming back. Love to hear from you. Drop me a line, twowayprayer@gmail.com.